Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our program tonight on TalkShoe. Appreciate you all you folks being there in the chat room tonight. This will be our episode on the timeline of deception. And tonight we have a special guest, Brother Mark Sargent from Flat Earth Clues and EnclosedWorld.com. That is the right website, isn't it, Brother Mark?
It is the right website, EnclosedWorld.com, indeed.
All righty. And tonight we're going to be dealing with the clues to the flat earth that Mark is famous for now all across the internet world and regular radio world as far as that goes. But, folks, I'm going to tell you something. You've heard for about the last 3 or 4 weeks in these episodes on Timeline of Deception, I've covered this topic, and most of you guys have heard me come out of the closet and finally give over, even though I claimed to be a Bible believer, all right, a biblical literalist. I was denying this one, okay? So I had to stick with the Word of God, little W, and the big W, Word of God. I had to change horses, and I'm on this horse from now on, period. Like I said, if this one's proved to be wrong, then us biblical literalists from Irenaeus and Polycarp and Ignatius, we all in a heap of trouble on our biblical interpretation. Now, them guys after 200 A.D., no big deal. That's when all the allegory and metaphor and junk come in. I'm talking about our early church fathers. But anyway, how you doing, Brother Mark?
I'm doing well. Thanks very much, Don, for having me on.
No, brother, it's a pleasure. And this is what I wanted to say that I was mentioning before the program started. Folks, the reason, Mark, and you're going to hear it tonight, if some of you haven't been and heard some of his stuff from some of my previous teaching mentioning him, then I'll tell you why he's as popular as he is. You're going to run into folks out there that's going to start hollering shill and holler this and holler that about how professional his videos are and everything. And it's got nothing to do with his professionalism. It's got to do with his spirit and his persona. Those other guys out there that are pushing this truth, and there's some good ones. Most of them got filthy mouths. Most of them are, you know, they're likable, but they got their character flaws. But Mark brings a perspective it's spiritual. There is a spiritual aspect to this that he brings to the table. It's not just the fact-based things, even though he's got the facts, but there's a spirit there. At least there was to me, and it's a hope-based. It's hope-based facts. It's not fear-mongering. It's not doom and gloom per se, even though we know what the Word of God says, how it's eventually going to end up. I have my thoughts on that. I may mention them after a while about what's going on right here with this revelation of the flat earth movement at this period in history. But Mark's persona is different. It's spiritual, and he brings charity. That's another thing. He brings charity to the table where a lot of the other guys don't. And like I said, I'm not bad-mouthing Eric Dubay or Jaronism or Mark or Matt, whatever you want to call him, from NASA. I'm not bad-mouthing them. That's their care. They'll have the ones that listen to them. But Mark's going to have more people listen to him, I believe, because he's got a spiritual aspect to it. And he puts the truth out there, and he's got a book that backs him up that'll stand while the world's on fire. Anyway, after having said that, I'm going to turn it over to you, Brother Mark, in just a second, and I want you to give us a little background, back when you was a child, growing up, how things went in your life, up to the present, how you got started in all this, and you know, I told you before the program started, that's what I wanted you to do, give a little background.
Sure.
Okay, but before we do that, Brother David, if you would open us in a word of prayer, brother.
Certainly. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you tonight, and we give thanks that at this time and that in our generation, you are reviving your word among your people, and you are awaking the nations to the fact that you created this world the way it is and it speaks of your glory. It reveals your character and your nature and your power and your majesty and the presence that you have with us constantly as you gaze with the hosts. For there are a cloud of many witnesses who gather and watch what we do here on this planet. And Father, at this time we pray that your Holy Spirit would reach out to those in the chat room and to the many who download from the archives, and that your Spirit would reveal the truths that are being revealed through Mark, through Don, and through the Word of God, that you would shake people's hearts and minds and cause them to be at ease until they receive your truth. And we pray that your Holy Spirit magnify the Lord Jesus Christ here tonight in all that what we say and do, that the center of our life, the one who sits on the seat of our ego, who sits on the seat of our personalities, who sits on the seat of our character, who sits as Lord and ruler of our very lives and of this planet, is the Lord Jesus Christ. And we acknowledge him and we ask, Holy Spirit, that you glorify our Lord Jesus Christ here tonight. And I pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ. So be it.
Amen. Amen. Okay, Brother Mark, if you all would, right, go ahead and take it, brother.
Sure. I'll go
and
way
I'll wait
back.
By just one more second. You guys in the chat room, let Brother Mark get started, and if you've got any questions, type them in, and Brother Kevin can come in at the appropriate time and break in on Brother Mark, or not break in on him, but at the specific time, and let him answer any questions you have. Is that okay with you, Mark?
Yeah. Feel free to interrupt any time.
Okay,
I do not mind at all.
Okay, Brother.
I do a lot better with back and forth. I'll go a little farther back than I normally do in other interviews, and that is, I was born and raised on Whidbey Island, Washington. That's up just north of Seattle. And I was raised born-again Christian, went to the Christian Missionary and Alliance Church for years and years, in fact, all the way up until the point where I left for college. And when I was doing the college thing, I was broadened as much as I could be. And then shortly afterwards, I went out to Colorado and played computer games professionally. So, all those people that say, that such a thing doesn't exist, oh no, it's rare, but it does exist. So I got to play computer games for a living. Normally you do it, out in California somewhere, but I got to do it for a small developer out in Colorado, and that was a lot of fun. Got to go to conventions like Macworld in Boston and San Francisco and E3.
Wow.
Yeah, that was a blast. And
I used to live in Denver myself. I like Denver pretty much.
Oh, cool. Cool. I'd never been out to Colorado. As a matter of fact, when I first flew out here, I flew out during a blizzard, and this was just before the DIA, the strange, weird DIA airport opened, and so I flew into Stapleton during a blizzard, and I thought I was landing at the wrong airport. I thought I was in Alaska. Seattle doesn't get a lot of snow. And people drive really, really fast in the snow here because, the plowing systems are fairly good. But anyway, I stayed here, and after that, the gaming company folded, I ended up doing proprietary software training for a lot of people, a lot of tech support, a lot of, traveling on the road, doing classroom training in different types of proprietary software. And I did that for the better part of 20 years. And as a matter of fact, my 20-year anniversary is coming up here real shortly. And during that time, because I never got married, never had kids. I was just constantly working and working and really sunk myself into my career.
Mm-hmm.
I got into the conspiracy world. It was just one of those things. Especially as the internet blossomed, there was a lot more information being passed back and forth on topics that weren't in the mainstream media.
Oh, yeah, Alex Jones. You probably went through all that, right?
Yeah, I wasn't a huge fan of Alex Jones just because he was a little too excited for me most of the time. That's about the best way I could put it. I mean, he seems like a nice enough guy, and I watched his early work when he was that's a whole other story for another time. But I went through a whole bunch of conspiracies and the garden variety stuff. And if you ever want to digress into those, that's perfectly fine. But I had done it for enough years that about middle of last year, I was kind of bored of the stuff that was out there. I was like, I think I'd seen it pretty much. I'd gone through all the major ones and all the minor ones and had my opinions on just about everything. So This one, the flat Earth, you know, the website is called Enclosed World because
right.
when you say flat Earth, people really brace against it. They don't know
yeah.
what to do with it. They
That's right.
people get angry. They get they go into immediate denial because we're taught since we're small children, that 1 + 1 = 2 and that the Earth is a globe. It's one of the few things that's really burned into our heads. And it's same with me. So whenever it crossed my desk, I was going, oh, this piece of junk, oh, this piece of crap. And I would just throw it off my desk. I was like, oh, no, I'm never looking at this thing, never, ever. But sometime during last summer, I looked at it because it's like, all right, you know what, why not? What's it going to hurt? I'll look at it. But I remember when I was first kind of delving into it, I was actually physically embarrassed for even looking at it. I mean, honestly, my face turned red and I was getting flushed and I was trying to figure out why. It's like, why am I embarrassed to look at this? I mean, I've looked at the lizard people thing and shapeshifters and just about every other thing you could think of, but this one was causing a physical reaction with me. And I thought, I thought I could just get through it. I thought I could just stomp it out and knock it out and really be done with it in less than a week. A weekend, maybe a week tops. And boy, did that turn to be the biggest mistake of my life. Because the more I dug into it, the more things started to unravel. The first one I got into was the German guy that was talking about the plane routes in the Southern Hemisphere. He goes, look, the plane routes are really wrong. He goes, they don't make any sense unless, of course, the Earth is flat. And I was going, okay, all right.
Yeah, that's
whatever.
The long haul clue, isn't it?
That's what eventually turned out to be the long haul, and then the magic show.
Right.
Yeah. And then I was looking at Matt Boylan's video, the guy that worked as a contractor for NASA, the Canadian artist who worked as a contract painter when he was in his 20s.
Yep.
And he told the story about how NASA, during a little intimate gathering with a lot of high-level mucky-mucks from NASA, how one of them was disclosing to him, in a fairly intimate setting, private setting, that that the world wasn't actually round, that it was way more flat than it was round. And I listened to the story, and it was a good story. And he told it very sincerely, and I was going, wow, that is really, really strange. So then I really started digging into it more, and over the next 9 months, really from the middle of last year up until February of this year, I just dug into every little aspect of it, and really by the beginning of this year, by the end of last year, beginning of this year, I had flipped from the point where I was trying to disprove flat Earth to where I was coming around and saying, okay, how do we know it's actually a globe? How do we know? How could I prove this to somebody? How could I walk up to somebody on the street and say, okay, let me prove to you how it's a globe?
There's only three, there's only three things people can do, and that's NASA, the government, or the military. That's it.
There you go. Yeah, and really, and the lines between those three are very, very blurred because NASA, most people don't realize, most people think of NASA as like a Star Trek, Starfleet, scientific group, and it is not. It is a military
right.
wing of the United States government.
Right.
More specifically, the United States Air Force. It was completely founded on military technology, and their budget is in line with a lot of military budgets. But so in February of this year, I had that moment, that weird moment where I woke up in the middle of the night. I know exactly, the date and the time. It was February 10th at about 3:30 in the morning. And something woke me up, and I felt like I had a fever. I felt like I was ill, really, like I had the flu. And I was going, holy smokes, what's wrong with me? And I had the narrative in my head, in my own voice, which was even weirder. And it was basically I had everything laid out. So I got up, and as I was in the shower, I was writing the script in my head, based on the narrative. And then I just
right.
sat down at the computer, did not revise it really at all. And wrote the first one out, that morning, did the video clips, put everything together in Windows Live Movie Maker and threw it up on YouTube. And then that whole process started again the next night and the next night to where I had done the introduction and the first 7 clues in 8 days, just cranked them out. And to the point where something I could not stop until I got to clue 7. And then finally, my mind just gave out, and I just said, okay, I can take a break now. And then I slowed down, and then finally, you know, slowly over the next couple of weeks, released 8, 9, 10, and 11.
Right.
And as I was doing that, as I had really, by the time I had gotten done with clue 7, you know, because I put my email address and my phone number at the end of every clue.
Oh, yeah. Let me stop you there just a second. By the way, I wanted to thank you so much for that, because that's exactly what I did when I first went on the internet with the ministry. My address, my telephone number, and my email, where everybody else, you know, uses the fake handles and all that stuff.
Yeah.
You know, you can drive up to my front door by following the address. Go ahead, brother. I admire that.
Oh, no, you're absolutely right. That is, if my biggest pet peeve about the internet is the anonymous nature of it.
Amen.
And that is, you know, I've told Jonathan this several times, and that is, it's not, you know, it used to be, if you can't say something nice, don't say anything at all. But on the internet, that's not true. On the internet is, okay, I'm just going to create a fake name, and I'm going to say anything, you know, I darn well please.
Mm-hmm.
And it's gotten people into a lot of trouble. I mean, so many fights have broken out and senseless arguments based on, you know, because people won't use their real names.
Amen.
And it just, it just drives me insane. So
I really appreciated that, how candid you were and honest in putting your name, your real name and your phone number and everything there. That's very unique and stand up, and I really appreciate people who do that.
Amen.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome.
It for a couple reasons. One was because, you know, people were going to have questions about this. No question. You know, they were going to come at me. And at the same time, I wanted to be as legit as possible. You know, there's so many. If you come out and you be anonymous and you just throw this stuff out there, people are going to try to figure out who you are anyway. And it's okay, why are you hiding yourself?
Right.
And it worked. It really, really helps because people looked at this, you know, I put up my name, my address, my phone number, my backstory. You can look at my backstory going all the way back to, you know, Whidbey Island in Seattle. It's all there. It's, you know, it's not too hard to track down who I am.
That's part of the honest persona that I mentioned as the program started, Mark. That's why you're popular. That's why people everybody wants you for an interview. The persona is charitable and it's spiritual and it's honest. Go ahead.
Thank you. I tried to be, what you said, I tried to be as upfront as possible and as genuine as possible. And I know there was still going to be people out there that, you know, the naysayers, which is fine. I wasn't going to be able to avoid it entirely, but I did minimize it to the point where it was much, much easier to deal with.
Right.
And so far, it's gone very, very well. So anyway, as the clues were coming out, the phone calls started coming in. And then almost immediately, in fact, I had a guy that was notorious for trying to debunk stuff, fakeologist.com. He called me up out of the blue, did not preface anything. And then you probably heard that one where he's like,
right,
hey, can we record this like right here and now?
That's right.
But, okay, let's do it. And once the first couple interviewers crossed that line, the other ones didn't feel as embarrassed to bring it up as a topic. And then it just started feeding on itself to where people call me every week now and say, hey, you know, you want to do an interview, you want to talk about it, and they all do the same thing. You know, it's this routine where everyone says, I can't believe we're talking about this, and you know, is this really a serious topic? And you know, last year I would have said no, I would have laughed you out of the building like anyone else, but this year. Really, by the time I got to clue 2, I mean, I knew it, you know, that night that I woke up and you know, I knew it was true. I knew there was something really, really something substantial behind this. But by the time I had gotten to the Admiral Byrd stuff, I couldn't turn back. I was like, okay, I'm going to go with this for as long as I'm inspired to do it. And
You know, there's a lot of people out there in the conspiracy land. And I've got a Christian brother that is big into the hollow earth, and he thinks he won't even touch this. He won't even look at the clues or anything because he's afraid. He's so invested in UFOs and the hollow earth that he's afraid to touch this with a 10-foot pole.
And that's an excellent point, which is how many there's no other conspiracy I know of where even the conspiracy world it's taboo to.
That's right.
I mean, this is it's so strange. In fact, I had a guy just on this last show I just did who was a caller. He called in, and you could tell he had done his own podcast thing. And I did a little background checking on him after he had hung up in frustration.
Yeah, the one that hung up on you. I found out
he's part of a conspiracy convention, an exposition, you know, that's down in Hollywood,
wow,
California. And it's like, okay, this guy is part of an exposition group that all they do is deal with conspiracies. And he calls up and says, this thing isn't real. This isn't
right.
A real conspiracy. You know, I won't suffer fools, blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
It's like that shows you how big it is. You know, the conditioning is so good that even that most conspiracy people, again, you know, and I wasn't kidding in the first clue when I said that, you know, I can have a guy dressed in an alien costume talking to me, you know, that just went to, you know, a UFO convention, and I say flat earth and he'd just laugh and wave me off.
Yeah, no.
And walk away. And it's amazing. So
yeah,
that's where we are now. You know, it's July and August as of tomorrow. And this thing just is getting bigger and bigger. The amount of YouTube videos is just skyrocketed on, you know, the people that are covering this. And heck, there was even a, it's even starting just barely, as of this week, starting to bleed into the mainstream, Forbes magazine.
Yeah, I heard you talk about that.
Yeah, picked up the story, and it's the only one out there. And people are saying, well, if there's only one, it's like, look, mainstream doesn't touch stuff like this, especially this. And they did, because they thought it was really odd. It's like, you know, and again, it was related to Kent Hovind.
Right.
You know, getting out of jail, but it was interesting. It's like, wow, Forbes. I was like, well, that's pretty impressive. It wasn't like TMZ or some fringe, you know, thing that was picking it up. You know, might as well have been the Wall Street Journal.
That's right. And I predicted that whenever Brother Kent got out, some of these so quote unquote mainline big names, they were going to get hit head on with this flat earth thing. I said they're going to get hit and they're going to have to address it. And Brother Kent got hit immediately. And he took the same old position we used to have about, oh, Isaiah 40:22, and we know this and we know that. Brother Kent,
yeah.
I'm telling you, brother, if you listen to this, you better check it out with new eyes.
I have a funny feeling that and I posted this on one of the people that did his video on YouTube, and I said, look, it didn't surprise me, of course, his reaction, because
sure,
look,
he just got out.
He doesn't want to seem crazy on camera right off the bat. So, but it's in his head now, I guarantee it, you know, because there's so many people that were asking about it that, you know, now he's going to have to go home, and he's probably researching it, banging his head on the desk just like I was.
Yeah, so. And there's another brother out there named Trey Smith. I don't know if you're familiar with his stuff. He's done got busted. I busted him myself on his Facebook page yesterday. So he's done tried to say, no, there ain't nothing to it. He's going to have to deal with this because people are not going to leave him alone.
yeah.
There's one thing that Rob Skiba said that sticks in my mind, and that's the saying, condemnation before investigation is the height of ignorance.
It is the height of ignorance. The Bible says in Proverbs that he that answereth the matter before he hears it is a shame and folly unto him.
I did not know there was a biblical equivalent to that.
Yes, absolutely.
That's really, really good. Yeah, I've been trying to memorize that particular phrase just because that's really what applies here more often than not, because people will come. And here, again, you know, for people that are listening to this now or in the archives, here's the part where you got to get your head around it, and that is, do you know, people, of course, we know where we live on. We live on a globe, obviously. However, do you know because you remember the globe in your classroom when you were 6 years old and it was there for years and years? Or do you know because you saw the picture that NASA gave you in 1972, you know, that was in all the textbooks? Because then you're running into some problems. Then you're running into faith in government, or in this case, faith in the military.
There you go. Military, the government, and NASA. Yeah. That's the three gatekeepers on this. And Brother Rob Skiba picked it up immediately. He's a great brother. I can't wait till he comes all the way on board. And I understand why he's trying to get a television series going. But still, if you're a seeker for the truth, you got to forget about the credibility, forget about the reputation. If you really are honest in your heart and want what the Bible says, the Bible is a flat earth book. I don't care what anybody says. If you interpret the scriptures literally or take them for what they say, because in 1 Peter and 2 Peter chapter 1, the last verse says there's no scripture of any private interpretation.
Yeah.
So if you interpret privately, you done screwed up to start with. Go ahead, Mark.
Yeah.
And
it's good that you brought up Rob, because he was one of the people that he's the one of the main reasons I got my own little radio show, is that he interviewed me on True Frequency Radio, and you could tell he was on the fence, but we were going back and forth, and he was looking at it from a scripture standpoint, but you could tell the wheels in his head started spinning to where after he was done, that's all he could think about. And then he, all of a sudden, people were emailing me saying, "Have you seen what Rob's been doing?" I was going, "No." And he created a website called
The Best. He's got the best website out there, brother.
Yeah, testingtheglobe.com.
That's right.
And it goes really chapter and verse from Genesis to Revelation, every reference to everything that's tied in with this. Tons and tons of content. And amazing amount of work that he's done. He's done just hours and hours and hours of documentary style footage on YouTube. Yeah, it's only a question of time before he releases a book on this.
Absolutely.
And if a television show happens for him, hey, I'm happy for him. It's a wonderful aspect and wonderful to see where this is going in different directions. And it's inspiring.
But that television program series he's trying to get is called The Seed. It's got it's got nothing to do with the flat earth. But he said on one of his radio programs, he said, "Oh, I'm gonna have to change some of the plot lines if I go all the way with flat earth." And that's one of the things I wanted to say about this whole thing. If people will be honest and think about this, just think about this, Mark, of all the dogma that's attached to the globe.
Sure.
All the dogma of all kind of things. It's like I told my folks that listen to me. If I've taught you any doctrine that is connected with a global earth, forgive me. I repent. I'll have to tell you, I was wrong. But it wasn't I was lying. It was I was deceived.
Yeah, I mean, the church hundreds of years ago, it was a tough call for them, because it seemed like a small change in the grand scope of things, going from a flat enclosed firmament type system to a globe.
Right.
But because really, what does it matter, right? Well, now we know. Now,
yes, we do.
Now we know it actually matters a great deal.
I've got a sneaking suspicion, and I've told my folks that listen to me, this is part of, I think it'll be a 3 or 4 pronged attack with a great deception, but this is going to have a big deal to play in the final deception that's coming upon this world. I guarantee you.
I agree, and I'll take it even one step further, because people have asked me, part of the reason I've been labeled, somewhat, because they say, well, I'm getting too much attention too fast, I'm not getting any resistance, suits and sunglasses haven't shown up at my door yet from any organization. But at the same, I was half expecting them. I was like, honestly, waiting for that knock on the door, where I'm just looking at, guys with mirrored cop sunglasses and really horrible suits. And actually, their suits aren't that bad. But it hasn't happened. And even my mother, who is a devout Christian,
yeah, I heard you talking about that.
Done quite a bit of ministries overseas, Uganda a couple times. She was going to do the Pacific Rim, but that's a whole other story. She comes back and says, there's a reason for this. There's a reason this is being allowed to happen, and that you're doing this. I was going, maybe, because I have gotten, not only have I gotten no resistance, I haven't even solicited anybody when it comes to the people that are interviewing, the people that they're putting feelers out for other media outlets on this.
Right.
It's been really, really fascinating to watch. You would think that, I would have problems with my YouTube channel or my webpage, or something along those lines. And I haven't. And it's been, and not only that, but everyone that's been coming after me has been running into their own problems.
Yeah, that's true.
I don't want to name names.
No, don't do that, brother.
No, I won't do that. But it's been, And look, I never, ever, ever set out to be a spokesperson for this thing by any stretch. You know, when I put the YouTube videos up, you know, I didn't allow comments. I didn't allow ratings at first. I do now. And I didn't monetize anything because, you know, I figured I'll just keep this thing as low key as possible. And really, the when I put it out there, it was more of a challenge to the internet, what I call the internet hive mind. I said, look, show me how it's a globe. Somebody prove me wrong. Prove, right. And not just me. I didn't invent this concept by any stretch, but show me that the whole concept is wrong. Somebody has a magic bullet out there that can shoot this thing down. And I was half expecting, really, when this thing came out, that all of a sudden somebody would make a video and say, okay, here's why it's a globe. Here are the facts. That's unbelievable. You know, there's no contradiction whatsoever in any way, shape, or form. It's completely ironclad, and you can stop making videos now. And here we are, you know, in August, months and months later, and it's like, look, if the internet hasn't figured out a way to stomp this thing out by now, I have serious doubts that they're going to. I mean, yeah, you can rule Neil deGrasse Tyson out,
don't get me started on him, please.
Well, he may be able to weave something, but even he, if he's watching the clues, is going to have some problems with it because there's a bunch of questions that he's not really, not necessarily prepared to answer, not allowed to answer. You know, everything from the Van Allen radiation belt to the no panning shots and I'm sure.
Yeah,
the thing
about it is, Mark, there nobody can touch it without NASA,
yeah,
government, and military. Once you sideline those, everything is 110% flat Earth.
Yeah.
All the mathematics, all the horizon tests, all of
yep.
it.
Yeah. And you know what's amazing to me is the people that are holding on to NASA from the Apollo standpoint. Well, not holding on to it, but the first thing you've got to remember is, again, for people that don't know what I'm talking about here, you know, I haven't even really said what we're talking about here.
No, you hadn't even gotten into the clues yet.
And that is, the premise is, for those listening, is that I'm going to use the Truman Show reference again because it's the easiest for people to digest. For people who haven't seen the 1998 movie, the Truman Show, we'll take the biblical reference and cross-reference it with it, is that if there is if you built the world flat and you put a big dome-like structure over it and put the stars on the inside and the sun and the moon hovering above, could if you made it big enough, could you hold an entire civilization in there without them knowing it? Because you fooled Truman, and that was easy. But the thing is, you have to be born into it. Generations of people have to be born into it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so the question is from Genesis, because I know where you're going with this, and that is, if the firmament is real, then it's not a globe.
Well, real. It's mentioned 17 times in the Word of God.
There you
go.
And
it is a solid structure that encloses the earth, and the moon and the sun and the stars are put in it, not outside of it, but in it.
There you go. There you go. And if you want me to bring this up later, I will. But the Tower of Babel story, which...
That's where this whole timeline of deception, I started the whole series. I think this is going to be part 19 or 20. I started with the Tower. Well, I started in the Garden of Eden with Genesis 3:15, with the deception of Eve and Adam, and then I went on to the Tower of Babel. But go ahead, brother. Keep on.
Oh, no, it's okay.
Rob, I covered it.
I'm sorry, what?
Rob, can I ask you something?
Yeah.
Can I ask you a question? Okay,
yeah.
Do you want to know why God's using you?
Sure.
Okay.
I can give you one reason.
Now, it's not the exclusive reason, I'm sure, but it is a big reason, and it's three verses in Romans chapter 1, and I don't believe you've heard this.
It starts at
verse 18, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold truth in unrighteousness." So that means that they're suppressing or holding back or lying about the truth. They're going to be judged. And it goes on to say in verse 19, "Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them," in those truths. That's what it's saying. "For God hath shewed it unto them, verse 20, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse.
Amen.
So if you can manifest to the world the true creation, people are going to be up face to face with God in a whole new way, and God is going to get the glory, the honor, and these people will be led to repentance, led to the Lord Jesus Christ, because they'll finally see his invisible power, his glory, his honor, his majesty in that which he has created, and the veil will be lifted.
Yeah, Brother Mark gets to that in Hiding God.
I do.
Like,
but that's a wonderful quote. Thank you.
Yes,
thank you very
is.
Much.
I seen those. Thank you.
And one day, Mark, I've been wanting. I started to email you this, and
yeah.
I said, "No, I'm gonna wait till I get him, talk to him online when
okay.
we're on the telephone." There, the verse that nobody is quoting out there that just absolutely slams science to the curb, and it's in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 20. Read it, Brother David, about what Paul says we're supposed to beware of. And the reason they don't do it out there, because they got all these screwy different versions, and we're King James only here. It's in a King James Bible, and it's only in a King James Bible, but it warns you of science falsely so-called. And nobody touches on that. Brother Rob Skiba hadn't even mentioned it yet. I couldn't believe it. It is. It is. Read it, Brother David.
1 Timothy 6, verse 20. O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust, avoiding profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science, falsely so-called.
Science, falsely so-called. If you obey the scriptures, the literal interpretation is the correct one, then you would be wary of anything that comes out that's quote-unquote science that's not science. Science,
yeah.
Falsely so-called. Go ahead now, Mark. I'm sorry.
Oh, no, it was okay. So where I was going with this was, the Sunday school question, which had always bothered me, which was the Tower of Babel, because if you're building, this giant structure building, to reach the heavens, it's like, how are you doing this on a globe? Because if you're in the middle of space, you're not going anywhere. Plus, the Earth is spinning. And which means that building is also spinning with it, and on the Earth's rotation, and the Earth is moving through space, which means that the building's also going in a completely separate direction. I was going,
yes.
That didn't make any sense. But as soon as I got into this, I was going, now it makes perfect sense, because and I'll rattle them off real quick. If the Earth isn't moving, 1 Chronicles 16 verse 30. Psalm 93-1, Psalm
67 verses, over 67.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, they all say the same thing. He has fixed the earth firm, immovable. Thou hast fixed the earth immovable and firm. You know where I'm going with this.
Right, sure.
And there was that, and you guys will know this better than me. Unfortunately, I'm not brushed up on my stuff. That one where the story where God held the sun in the sky an extra day.
Oh, it's Joshua chapter 10.
Perfect.
Yes.
That story. It was like, wow. It's like, how hard and difficult that would be to hold the sun in the sky? And people say, well, God is infinite. Yeah, but in a fixed system, in a firmament system, that's not hard at all. You just literally hold the sun in the sky. You don't have to do anything special with the earth or the rotation or anything like that. You just keep it in the sky and nothing else changes. And then, you want to keep slaying your enemies? Go right ahead.
That's right. And on top of that, it puts a new light on the worldwide flood.
The flood is way easier.
And it makes when Nimrod's going to build a tower into heaven, it puts a whole different slant on that too.
Yeah. 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 It's there's too many things that fit nicely for the average Christian to ignore.
Right.
And I know you want to be the modern Christian, and you want to, it's like, well, we kind of agreed it was a globe a long time ago. And it's like, yeah, but that's just more of a peer pressure thing. You agreed.
Absolutely.
You went along just to get along.
I see it.
And now here we are, 2015. Now it's coming back, and now it's you got to dust that thing off and show people what it's really about.
Absolutely. And let me get this on air right now. Y'all notice that Brother Mark is coming from this with a kind of a pragmatic look. It's not that he doesn't understand the supernatural part of God or any of that. He's hitting a worldwide audience, and he's coming from a kind of a pragmatic type view of what God would do, this, that, and the other. It's kind of a pragmatic look. It's not that he don't understand the omniscience and omnipresence and supernatural part of God. It's not that. He's got a bigger audience, and he's doing the right thing. This is exactly way it should have been approached.
Please, anyone listening, I am not trying to diminish God by any stretch. What I'm saying is that God has tools like everyone else.
Well, of course, and as
his tools happen to be a lot more advanced. You know, they're divine tools.
That's
but
right.
he still has stuff to measure with and build stuff. You know, so when it comes to the construction of this place, people say, well, why didn't he build a solar system? And I'm saying because the efficiency of this place is divine. There is nothing wasted here. There is no wasted solar system, you know, where there's all massive amounts of vacuum and empty space and everything. I'm saying everything is extremely compact and very, very, very well designed.
Yep, let me give you another reason. It's just like whenever my daughter brought this point. By the way, you've got a convert. Also, my daughter, she's on board 100%. But anyway, she said, Dad, she said, guess what? I just thought about something. Mark said this, that, and the other about how the Lord did this. And I said, what are you talking about, Cam? She said, back when he sent the angels to Sodom and Gomorrah. How come he sent the angels? Why didn't he just think it in his mind? He sent those angels to check out what was going on in Sodom and Gomorrah.
Yeah.
And I said, I understand, baby. So, yeah, she looked at it from the way you was looking at it, too. But anyway, I didn't mean to interrupt.
Yeah.
Go ahead, brother.
No, not at all. No, it's a good point. There's a power structure, you know, a hierarchy.
Yeah, it's called the Divine Council, by the way. I've got a big series on that, but go ahead.
There you go. You know, it's you know, even God needs companionship, it seems, you know, and groups to, groups to command.
He delegates authority is what it is, Mark. His stuff down. Nobody sits around playing a harp on a cloud, okay? That's Catholic BS, all right? Nobody's sitting around on a harp. Everybody's got a job to do, and his creation has a job to do. His children have a job to do, and so does his messengers, and so does his seraphim, his cherubim. They all have a job to do. But anyway, brother, you can go ahead now and get in the clip.
Okay.
#BTC4. Now, already some weeks ago, I have written on my to-do list to translate the video BTC4, hashtag BTC4. Schon seit ein paar Wochen habe ich auf meiner To-Do-Liste geschrieben, den Video BTC4 in Deutsch zu übersetzen. Estoy segura que esta idea puede ayudar a mucha gente económicamente. I'm sure that this can help many people economically. Ich bin sicher, dass diese Idee vielen Leuten finanziell helfen kann. Y da motivación para aprender Bitcoin. And give motivation to learn about Bitcoin. Und Motivation geben, über Bitcoin zu lernen. En este momento el precio de Bitcoin es muy bajo, económico. At the moment the price of Bitcoin is very low, economic. Im Moment ist der Preis von Bitcoin sehr tief. Sería el momento ideal para invertir. Hoy es el 15 de abril 2015. Would be the ideal moment to invest. Today is April 15th, 2015. Es wäre der ideale Moment zu investieren. Heute ist der 15. April 2015. El 27 de marzo 2015 he publicado en mi canal de YouTube Vanos Enigma el primer video sobre hashtag BTC4 explicando cómo me vino esta idea. On March 27th of 2015, I published the first video about hashtag BTC4 in my channel YouTube Vanos Enigma, explaining how I got the idea. Am 27. März 2015 habe ich in meinem YouTube-Channel Vanos Enigma den ersten Video über Hashtag BTC4 veröffentlicht und erklärt, wie ich diese Idee bekommen habe. La idea consiste principalmente en lo siguiente. The idea mainly consists in the following. Die Idee besteht hauptsächlich in folgendem. Imprimir direcciones de Bitcoin en papel. Mínimo 10 o mejor 100. To print Bitcoin directions in paper, at least 10 or better 100. Bitcoin Adressen in Papier ausdrucken, minimal 10 oder besser gleich 100. Y luego poner en cada dirección de Bitcoin una pequeña cantidad de Bitcoin. And then put in every Bitcoin direction a little amount of Bitcoin. Und dann in jede Bitcoin-Adresse eine kleine Summe von Bitcoin transferieren. Y la próxima vez, cuando otra vez ves una persona por la calle pidiendo dinero, and the next time you see again a person begging for money on the street, Und das nächste Mal, wenn du wieder eine Person auf der Straße betteln siehst, y para tus amigos y amigas, and for your friends, of course, und für deine Freunde natürlich, o tal vez de propina en un restaurante, or maybe a tip in a restaurant, oder Trinkgeld im Restaurant. Bueno, a la hora de imprimir también copiar y guardar las llaves privadas de Bitcoin, de direcciones de Bitcoin. Or when you print the Bitcoin addresses, copy and save the private keys of the Bitcoin addresses, of course. Wenn man die Bitcoin-Adressen druckt, auch die privaten Schlüssel, Bitcoin-Address-Schlüsseln, kopieren und speichern. Y a la hora de distribuir las direcciones de Bitcoin, escribir la fecha, por ejemplo, hoy es el 15 de abril 2015, escribir la fecha más plus 4 años, igual 15 de abril 2019. And then in the moment when you distribute the Bitcoin addresses, you write the date, for example, today, April 15th, 2015, plus 4 years is April 15th, 2019. Und dann in dem Moment, wenn man die Bitcoin-Adressen verteilt, auf das Papier schreiben, das heutige Datum, zum Beispiel 15. April 2015, plus 4 Jahre ist gleich 15.04.2019. Luego vas a explicar a la gente, mira, esta es la llave privada. Tú y yo la tengo, la tienes. Si no quitas, transfieres este dinero de Bitcoin en estos 4 años, yo lo vuelvo a tener o sacar. Then you explain to the people, look, this is the private key. I have it and you have it. If you don't take this money, Bitcoin, out of this account, I will take it out in this in these 4 years, at the end of these 4 years. Und dann erklärst du den Leuten, schau, das ist der private Schlüssel. Ich und du haben diesen privaten Schlüssel, Bitcoin-Schlüssel. Wenn du bis Ende dieser 4 Jahre das Geld Bitcoin nicht raustust, Transfer, dann hole ich es zurück. De esta forma das más motivación a la gente para empezar a aprender cómo funciona Bitcoin. This way you give more motivation to the people to learn how the technology of Bitcoin functions. Auf diese Weise gibst du mehr Motivation den Leuten zu lernen, wie die Technologie von Bitcoin funktioniert. In mi video antiguo.
In the ancient Jewish temple, a large veil blocked access to the Holy of Holies, where the presence of God dwelled. It was a constant reminder that sin separated us from God. Nobody was allowed in except for the high priest, and then only once a year. On the Day of Atonement, the high priest would pass through the veil to offer a sacrifice for the sins of Israel. This continued for generations, because the sacrifice could never be good enough. Fortunately, it was just a foreshadowing of what was to come. 2,000 years ago, something changed. A new sacrifice was offered. A perfect sacrifice. One final sacrifice for all of time. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. He paid the ultimate price so that the sins of all men could be forgiven. At the moment of his death, the large veil in the temple, the very thing that represented centuries of separation from God, was torn. Torn in two from the top down, showing that this era of separation was over. With his own blood, not the blood of goats and calves, he entered the Holy of Holies once and for all time and secured our redemption forever.
We read in the book of Exodus that the temple had a veil, was to have a veil, a cloth curtain, separating the most holy place, the Holy of Holies, from the rest of the holy place. There are sections within the temple building itself that are more holy than others, where access is restricted more than other places. And the most holy place, where only the high priest can go once a year, is separated from the rest by this curtain. This, I would imagine it would be fairly substantial in order to give the sanctity and the aura of holiness behind it.
In the temple, the priest would offer sacrifices in the holy place. But once a year, he would bring a sacrifice beyond a thick veil, a curtain, and that would go into the Holy of Holies, and there he would offer the Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement sacrifice. And that sacrifice, which is almost, in my opinion, when we get a credit card, it's like paying the minimum and not really dealing with the debt, but paying the minimum and paying the minimum. And when the Messiah came and when he died, his sacrifice, though outside the gate of the city, actually is the final sacrifice for sin. It is the one that all these interim Yom Kippur sacrifices were leading up to. They were pointing to this one that was coming. And now this one, not the blood of bulls and goats, but the blood of God's Son, the Messiah himself, as he dies, that veil, that thick veil, is torn in half to say that no other sacrifices need be offered here. The final payment has come. It's been taken care of. And so the tearing of the veil indicates the permanence, the final sacrifice of the Messiah Jesus.
In the Old Testament, God chose to dwell among his people in the temple. And if a holy God is going to dwell amongst unholy people, there has to be some way to protect his holiness from the unholiness of Israel. So he had this elaborate scheme of who could enter his presence behind a veil. No one could go past here. Only the most sacred of priests who had fully cleansed themselves once a year would go into the Holy of Holies. So in a sense, the people knew he was there, but had no accessibility to him.
God, I believe, when he ripped that veil, I can just imagine those almighty hands, boom, ripping that veil. What he did is he said, come on in. You're welcome. You don't have to stay out there anymore. You can come in, and you don't have to be perfect to come into my holy place, because Jesus has made a way for you.
I love the word access in the Bible. Maybe it's because I'm in a wheelchair, I don't know, but I love when the Bible speaks about God's love being accessible, and right there you've got such a vivid physical symbol of the access, the doors thrown open wide to the throne of God.
And when it rips in two by itself at the death of Jesus, not only is it saying something theologically about open access to God. But it's something that had a very dramatic, must have had a very dramatic impact on everybody who was watching and those whom they told about it. A event that really overturns, that makes us think again about why it was there. And that both destroys and opens new opportunities at the same time.
España.